music, the people, the what. Good evening, saints of the Most High God. Welcome to TNL Live. Woo! Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That was very soft. I don't know what's happening here.
Hallelujah.
Oh, there we go. I think it's my earpiece. I don't know. Let me put the other one in tonight. Looks like it wants both. Hallelujah. Praise God. Let's lift up our hands. We're going to greet some people first. Hallelujah. Okay. Good evening, Apostle Shelley. Wow. USA, you were the first ones on tonight. Hallelujah. Good evening, Apostle Shelley. I'm so excited that we're going to talk next week. Evening to you, Zai. Let's greet some people. Patsy, good evening to you. Where's Patsy? Did I leave her? It's this mouse. My mouse has gone wonky. Good afternoon. Good evening to you, Monica, in the USA. Hallelujah. Keep going. And to, of course, our prophet Mariki, good evening. Let's read that. Let our territories be shaken to release that which might be holding us back. To be shaken and allow us to step into the new. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Good evening, Max. Good evening, Di from the UK. Good evening, we greet you in the name of Jesus. And to our youth, Tando. Is that you? I didn't know. Prophet had to tell me that was you because you've got your double X, 10 double X. I don't know. Ilonka, good evening. Danielle, hallelujah. Good evening, Sheldon. Hallelujah. Pastor Peter, Teacher David, Pastor Max. And so we keep going. Kyle, good evening to you. Kyle, hallelujah. Vin, Nayeli, and Impo, good evening. We'll greet some more people a bit later as they come on. Amen. Praise God. Let's worship together for a moment. Come on, lift up your hands. Let's worship, let's worship. Oh, yarere yebashe, kora ma shandala nase, rokata mase. Oh, Jesus. Oh, la 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 la. Hallelujah, Jesus. We worship you, Lord. You're worthy to be praised and adored. We come before your presence with thanksgiving. We come into your courts with praise. Oh, Lord, we're moving from outer courts to middle courts to inner courts. Thank you, Lord, for the sanctuary where the veil has been torn. Thank you, mighty God, that we have access. Come on, shout it out. We have access.
Hallelujah.
We have access. Hallelujah. Ah, there's the name. Praise God. Let's see, I think you're busy on your phone, so I'm just trying to... Is there anyone else? No one. Okay. So we greet you in the precious name of Jesus. Welcome to TNL, saints. It's good to have you with us. I just want to bring that down a bit there to 35. Thank you. I just wanted to greet you all and just to remind everybody what we do on TNL. TNL is Thursday Night Live every Thursday at 7 p.m. CAT and round about 12 or 1 p.m. Eastern Time in the U.S. We come on live. It's always live 99.9% of the time. I don't think we've ever done played a video on our live broadcast, but we are live. And we have a whole myriad of things that we do on this broadcast. The first and foremost thing is that we give the Lord glory. The second thing is that we always make sure that we are geared and steered towards the kingdom. And the third thing is that we do lots of ministry on this. We do prophetic words. We allow the Spirit to move. We teach and we impart. And so there is a myriad of things, and we often have guests on as well from different affiliates and those that are part of our ministry and network. And we want to encourage you, just as you're watching tonight, to allow the Spirit of God to begin to flow, because God is doing something new. Somebody say shaking. Somebody say shaking. There is a shaking taking place. Hallelujah. There is a shaking. Yes, that's right, David. We have access. Thank you. Thank you, Apostle Shelley. We have access. Yes, yes. We have access. Are we accessing? That is so good. So good. That's right. That's right, Prophet. We teach, impart, share, and minister through the Holy Spirit. See, we don't want to do anything in our own strength in this on this broadcast, but we want to encourage you right now. If you'd like to help us, please go ahead and just hit that subscribe button and that like button for us. It helps us a lot. It really gives us more exposure, and that is what we're trying to do. We don't want as many randoms as we do people that genuinely watch our broadcasts. So please go ahead right now. If you don't subscribe, please subscribe to our channel and like the broadcast. And even more, if you want to go to step three, share it with somebody. Just click the share link over there in YouTube, or if you on Facebook. And there is also application there to give us stars. And of course, you know, there are super chats and super stickers on YouTube. So if you want the best quality, YouTube is the best platform, but we want to encourage you wherever you are just to watch. And later on, there will be an opportunity to give, and that will be something that if you believe that you are benefiting from this ministry, if you are blessed by this ministry, if you come on more regularly, we want to encourage you to think of sowing a seed and partnering with us by sowing a seed into this ministry. Amen. What are we doing? Oh, there's a super sticker right now. Let's put it up. Yes. Super sticker. Okay, we still haven't got through the, those are different characters, but yes. Hallelujah. Good evening, Elsa. We welcome you in the name of Jesus. We bless you. Hallelujah. And Unria. Unria and Elsa, we bless you in the name of Jesus. Welcome. And, you know, we're going to be getting our Connect group started pretty soon, so be on the lookout for that, because we're still uploading. Somebody say we're still uploading all our ministries. Amen. We're regrouping, we're uploading, and we are restoring. Amen. Praise God. Come on, I'm just going to put this. Just going to put this up a little bit over there. Hallelujah. We bless you, Lord. Let's just worship for a moment. Tell us how the volume is of the music, how the volume is for the moment before we start actually ministering. We like to bring it up. We like to create an atmosphere that is conducive for the Spirit of God to move among us, to prepare our hearts, to set our hearts in order. And Lord, we just speak right now that we would come into alignment with your word and all that you have to say to us tonight in the precious, mighty name of Jesus. We're still uploading. That's right, Max. Uploading 2.0. Amen. Lord, we bless your name and we thank you for this word and for all of those that are on here, Lord, that we would receive tonight. We bless you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise you, Lord. We praise you. We praise you. We praise you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Somebody say, don't despise the shaking. Don't despise the shaking. Put it in there. Don't despise the shaking. We like to put the hallelujah bits, but when it comes to don't despise the shaking, it's not so much. But I want you to put it in. I will not despise the shaking. I will not despise the shaking. I will not despise the shaking. I want you to turn with me in the scriptures to Haggai 2, 7 to 9. Haggai 2, 7 to 9. Haggai 2, 7 to 9. Everybody there, tell me if you're there. Say, I've got it. I've got it. Haggai 2, verses 7 to 9. The word of God says, and I will shake all nations. Somebody say all means all.
All means all.
And they shall come to the desire of all nations. That's with a capital D. They will come to the desire of all nations. So the Lord is saying that through the shaking, I draw you closer to me.
Come on.
Through the shaking, I am your desire. I want to be the desire of your heart. I want to be the desire of all that you are, the Lord would say to us tonight. And they shall come to the desire of all nations. That is Jesus Christ. And the word says, and I will fill this temple with glory, says the Lord of hosts. Verse 8, the silver is mine and the gold is mine, says the Lord. Now, never mind those seagulls that said mine. The Lord says clearly in Scripture, it is not yours, it belongs to me. Everything you have is mine. The silver is mine, the gold is mine, says the Lord. The glory of this latter temple shall be greater than the former. Now, you've heard me teach and preach on this many a time, and we're still going to teach and preach and go even deeper in the Word, especially as we come into the focus of speaking more on the bride, the Spirit and the bride, and the purity of the bride, as we move into this vision that the Lord cast for us last year. I want to encourage you that this is right now where we are going, that the latter, the glory of the latter house will be greater than the former. God's glory cannot permeate where there is impurity. The Lord will bless, the anointing can flow, but very seldom do you see that deep-rooted presence of God that literally shifts the atmosphere, that literally strips us, makes us feel that we are laid completely bare, that you see that coming in. And it is because the Lord is removing the impurities from the body of Christ. Yep. Say to somebody, the shaking is removing the impurities. The shaking is removing the impurities. And then the Lord says, and in this place I will give peace, says the Lord. In this place I will give peace, says the Lord of hosts. Ooh, in this place I will give peace. So Scripture is saying that everything that can be shaken will be shaken. It's saying nothing shall be left unshaken. It's not that God has some favorite person over here that is going to be left unshaken. Scripture says everything that can be shaken will be shaken. And we can't be in that pretense mode where we pretend that it is not happening. Because with the shaking comes either a drawing closer or a pulling away. Either we draw closer in the shaking because we recognize it and we understand what it is for, or we despise the shaking.
Come on.
We shift out of the plan of God. And we go, no, that's not for me. That's just too hard. God can't possibly want this for me. I'm going into a full-on prosperity ministry. I'm going into a place where all they speak about is rah, rah, rah. And if there are those on here that don't know what I mean when I say rah, 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 I'm talking about those that are just seekers after the euphoria of the Spirit, where they want the anointing, they want a touch from God, but they don't want to be changed by God. You cannot, what do you want? That's it. In the process, you need to be changed by the Lord, not just by touched. If you've come just for a touch and not to be changed, the shaking is going to shift you out of the plan, not toward the plan. Are you with me, saints? So everything, we can't pretend that the shaking will not happen. It is already taking place. We are feeling it. We are seeing it around the world. We are seeing it in churches. We are seeing it with ministries. We are seeing that God is shaking everything that can be shaken. And why? Because there's been a lot of deception that has crept in. A lot of deception has crept into the church. Hallelujah. I want to read something to you. I want to read something that is actually part of our, it's part of our DGAN fivefold school of ministry. It's part of what we actually, one of our core scriptures for that. I'm going to read it to you and you can underline it in your Bibles. Turn with me. The scripture reference is 2 Corinthians 4:2. 2 Corinthians 4:2. And some of you will recognize this. So Paul says it like this. We're talking about the shaking and the deception. We're saying don't despise the shaking because it's going to draw you closer. So Paul says here, in chapter 4, verse 1, Therefore, since through God's mercy we have this ministry, we do not lose heart. There was a shaking going on. Verse 2, rather we have, listen carefully, we have renounced secret and shameful ways. We have renounced secret and shameful ways. Saints, the only time we cannot be authentic when we enter the house of the Lord, or we say we're a Christian but we're not living that life, is when we refuse to renounce secret and shameful ways. Because those will keep you in a superficial faith. That's no faith at all. It's a shallow level of faith that you end up staying on that place of milk. Amen. Listen carefully. So he says, rather we've renounced secret and shameful ways. We do not use deception. Somebody say, no deception. We do not use deception, and nor do we distort the word of God. On the contrary, by setting forth the truth plainly, we commend ourselves to everyone's conscience in the sight of God. We can never ever think that we are just facing an audience or just facing people, even as ministers of the gospel, because God knows what we do in the dark. God knows what we do in the secret place. And either we're praying or we're doing something else. So we've got to understand, because he says here, we set forth the truth plainly and commend ourselves to everyone's conscience. And then he says, in the sight of God, and he says in verse 3, and even if our gospel is veiled, listen carefully, it is veiled to those who are perishing. The God of this age, I want you to hear this, is powerful scripture. The God of this age has blinded the minds. In this case, he says unbelievers, but I will show you in other parts of scriptures. Is blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel that displays the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. Who is the image of God. And that's where he goes on to say we are hard pressed and we are not crushed. We are in despair. We are persecuted, not abandoned. We are struck down, but we are not destroyed. Listen carefully, saints. It's not only the unbelievers in this age of kingdom. Somebody say we're in the age of the kingdom. We've moved on from the age of evangelicalism. Listen carefully. We still have to evangelize more than ever. The harvest is plentiful and the workers are few. Huge harvest that we need to bring in. But the church has to get herself pure. The church has to set herself in order. And that's what the Lord has been, that's been the theme for the last 2 years. The Lord has been speaking deeply to us to embark upon that which God has given us and to purify the bride, to take 1 Corinthians 7 and say that we must remove everything that contaminates. Amen. So that the Spirit of God is free to come and that the presence of God can saturate not just our temple here, but also that in our house of the Lord. Amen. And so it's not just the minds of unbelievers that have been blinded, but also the minds of believers. Because those that become religious minded, you've got to understand where we're going. This shaking is going to shake out the truth. It's going to expose the darkness for what it is. There are some that have kept things hidden for years and years. No more. I am telling you, there is a certain amount of grace that has been upon us in this past dispensation. And will there always be grace? Yes, there will always be grace. But there is a certain amount of grace that God has bestowed upon the body. But I believe this amount of grace now is being lifted to a higher level where the Lord is saying, if you want me to come, if you want the latter glory to be greater than the former, you have to come to a place where you purify yourselves so that I can come for a pure bride without spot or blemish. And so deceit is something that can no longer reside in our personal houses, this house of the Lord, my body, my temple, hallelujah, and the house of God, the corporate body of Christ, because it shall be exposed by the shaking. Say to someone, everything will be exposed by the shaking. And so Paul is saying here, we don't use deception. We've already renounced secret and shameful ways. We don't use deception, nor do we distort the word of God. On the contrary, we set forth the truth plainly. And so we are seeing now that those that have been manipulators of the word, those that have used the house of God for their own benefit, those that have brought themselves into places where they hide things, that will never ever display authenticity. Let me say something to you. The shaking will expose the darkness. And let me say this. It will expose those that cannot see and hear. Let me say this. There are many believers that once could see and hear. They could see and hear what the Spirit was saying. But you see, the religious spirit attaches itself to spiritual blindness. That's one of the deceptions, is that it is not just to the unbelievers. We used to always preach in the old days. We used to think all of these things were for unbelievers. No, they are not. Paul is speaking to the church. We have to understand something here, saints, that there are many that have come into the church and they were hot, they were on fire. Then all of a sudden, they had to move through their process. Say, I have to go through Nazareth. I cannot escape my Nazareth. If I don't go to Nazareth, I cannot move to Galilee. Shurabakataya Masanda. I just have to switch this on. I'm freaking out over here. Hold on. What am I doing? Oh, mode. I think I had it on heat. Oh. Thank you. It's okay. Okay. So let me carry on with this. So it's important for us to understand that we can be so easily deceived by, even in this time of shaking where everything is exposed, we have to understand that many of us were not born blind. When we talk about blindness, we're talking about spiritual blindness. We came into our house and we were excited. We found a place where the Spirit of God moved, but not just a place where the Spirit of God moved. We found ourselves in a place where we could be transformed. And the first thing we come into contact with is this amazing presence of God. We find this power of God upon us. We find there's this transforming. We find a setting free, and we are glad for that, and we see it, and we can testify to those things. But then all of a sudden the process continues. Part of the shaking is part of the process. There's a general shaking, but there's also shaking in the process. And what I mean by that is that sometimes we can move from those that can see and hear in the Spirit. In other words, those that don't understand the things of the Spirit cannot discern the things of the Spirit. They won't understand because they've moved into the religious spirit, binds itself and attaches itself to spiritual blindness. And that's why you get to a place where people that once could see and hear can no longer see and hear. And what people do when they can no longer see and hear, in other words, their spiritual blindness, they actually believe and think that they're hearing and seeing better than anybody else. They think that they've got it. They think that they've hit the revelation. They actually get so arrogant and prideful, and they don't even know that that is what is happening to them. Now listen to this, why it's so important. Because in that spiritual blindness where they can no longer see and hear, what happens is a religious spirit attaches itself to them. And that's when you get this. Suddenly, all of a sudden, there's criticism in the body. There's criticism over your leaders. There's criticism over the people. And that spirit of criticism comes from a religious spirit that binds itself to spiritual blindness. And I want to tell you, we are talking about the kingdom age. We are talking about having moved on into a kingdom age where God is moving the body of Christ into a kingdom mindset. And we have an unshakable kingdom, but in the earth realm, everything that can be shaken will be shaken. And you know, when you shake something and you keep shaking it, sometimes you shake the sand out of your clothes. If you've been to the beach, you shake the sand and you begin to shake and you think, oh my word, not everything has come out. There's still sand, and you have to shake it a little bit more. That's what's happening right now to the body of Christ. When the Lord says everything that can be shaken is being shaken, we've got to understand it's not just this little shake. Oh yeah, I'm just shaking this little bit of sand out of my clothes, just shaking this little bit of sand out of my slops because I've been to the beach. It is a shaking that will expose and remove everything. Prophet is saying next to me, it's almost like a violent shaking. A violent shaking. That's coming from our prophet. And so many of you were not born spiritually blind. You came to a place where you could see revelation, where you could hear revelation, where you could witness with the word being spoken on a Sunday, and you were the one amening, you were the one speaking, vocalizing, clapping, praising God, because your spirit was able to understand and see and hear. And then some things started to happen in your life, not just in the church, but there was a process that began in your life. And then all of a sudden, because remember, we're on this processing thing now. We are talking about spiritual maturity. We're talking about spiritual growth. If you go back the past 4 weeks, you'll see on every teaching, on TNL, on our visit to Cape Town, they're all up there on our YouTube channel. And even locally here, we've been starting with teaching on spiritual maturity, because the bride has to come to a place of spiritual maturity. And spiritual blindness will stop you maturing. It will stunt your growth. And in the shaking, if you remain spiritually blind, that religious little demon that attaches itself to you will make you think that you are right and everything in the church is wrong. And so suddenly you'll be saying, oh my gosh, why are they preaching that? That is so crazy. That I don't understand that. That doesn't even make sense. What do they mean? This is all revelation. I don't get that it's revelation. No, but you say it in arrogance when you're spiritually blind, because the Bible says that those that don't, and they don't understand the things of the Spirit won't grasp it. So it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, it says that God is going to bring to light what is hidden in the darkness and expose the motives of the heart. God will expose the motives of the heart. Why is that so important for us to know? Because it says that God, in chapter 1, it says that God has chosen the foolish things of the world to shame the wise, and the weak things of the world to shame the strong. And I just want to get the scripture quickly so that I can give it to you. So in chapter 1 of Corinthians 1, he says here in verse 18, Paul says, "For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God." Do you know that to us that are being saved, we forget what we were saved from? We can forget what we were saved for, and we can forget what we were saved from. Forgetting what you are saved from is taking for granted the blood of Jesus. And forgetting what you are saved for is the blindness that comes upon you when you don't continue the process. When you start moving back and you start shifting out of position, and you can no longer see the vision for your life. You can no longer see the future of your life. Because the word of God says, "I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the intelligence of the intelligent I will frustrate." Where is the wise person and the teacher of the law? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? Amen. So we need to understand that this shaking is part of the process of growth. God is maturing the body of Christ, because where we thought we were mature, where we thought we had it all, where we thought we had the revelation, where we thought we were in sync, I'm telling you, the shaking is going to show up a lot of stuff and shift a lot of stuff out of our beings, because we need to come to a place where we can see and hear what the word of God is saying again. Amen. An unshakable kingdom, but everything in this world that can be shaken. Listen, saints, we've got to understand that spiritual warfare is real. It's a real thing. It's not something that is all. The spiritual warfare is part of the shaking, but it's not your lot. The spiritual warfare is part of us being in the valley, but the Lord has given us the tools, 2 Corinthians 10:5, the tools that we need to demolish the strongholds of Satan. But if we are blind, if we remain spiritually blind, like the two that were on the road to Emmaus, that were kept from recognizing Jesus, and that comes also by losing our intimacy with Christ, by making decisions that are out of the will of God, by disobeying the will of God. Those are the things that make us spiritually blind. And the process that we have to stay in is the very thing that requires us to obey and follow the Lord. When we don't, we move out of the will of God, and we stop the process of our growth, and we stunt our growth, and we become spiritually blind, and a religious and demonic force attaches itself to us. Come on, you've got to understand. You may still come to church for a long while. You may still be in the process to a degree, but you will not allow the full yielding of what you need to do, the full shaking. What you will do is you may deny there's a shaking, or you may deny this, or you may deny that, and you end up pulling away. We can no longer live in denial. Say to someone, denial. Denial is not a good thing. Denial is not good. Denial is a river in Egypt. Hallelujah. Denial is not just a river in Egypt, we should say. Some people are going to go, what? With a religious spirit that's attached itself to spiritual blindness. Now you've moved from that place of spiritual awakening to spiritual blindness, where there's that religious veil that starts to cover your eyes. That's what Paul said. Even if people's eyes are veiled. And now what happens is we say, oh, I didn't see that demon. Why is the apostle always talking about the demon? Why is the prophet always talking about the shaking? Why is the apostle always talking about the need for spiritual growth? Why is there always this? Why is there always so much talk about healing? That's a religious spirit. Come on. You got to understand what you're dealing with. The religious spirit will come on you when you move out of the will of God, and it will bring a critical spirit into your being, and you will not recognize the revelation of the Holy Spirit coming, and you won't be able to receive. Now, all of that said, to say this, don't despise the shaking. Remain in the process, because it is a season of shaking. It is a season for you to move swiftly in your process. Swiftly. Come on, come saints.
Come on.
When you are spiritual, blinded, you can no longer sense and understand the deep things of the spirit. You may still understand something spiritually, but you will find yourself moving more to shallow ground and feeling more comfortable in a seeker-friendly environment. What are you seeking? Are you seeking the truth, or are you seeking something that is superficial? Come on, saints. Some people may say something like this, I don't need my leader to tell me. I've got the Holy Spirit. I hope so. I hope you're hearing the voice of the Holy Spirit, and I hope you've learned to hear the voice of the Holy Spirit, or I hope you're listening to the voice of the Holy Spirit, because these teachings and trainings and things we're doing on TNL and these times of preparation that we want to impart to you are so important, because we don't want you to be left out of the process so that you can move into the fullness of your calling, of what God has for your life. Amen. Because we have been blinded to a large extent. I just want to, you have already, okay. Hallelujah. We can't stay, listen, your leaders have been sent to help guide you into truth, to lead you. They haven't been told to tell you what to do. They're not there to do that. You have to make your own decisions. But if you refuse to even listen to your leaders because you have such a stubborn heart and a hard heart, you're going to miss out on your destiny. You're going to miss out on the calling. You're going to miss out on these amazing prophetic words that God has released upon the body of Christ and in your life. So don't despise the shaking. Don't despise the process. Don't try and short circuit or shortcut what God is doing. Listen, family, you are being shaken. Your reality is being checked. Your reality is being checked, because the shaking will produce a new level of faith for you. You will not be the same for better or worse. For better or worse. Amen? Let me read some comments here before I go any further. Prophet, do you want to give me some?
TNL is on fire.
TNL is on fire. Okay. Monica says, stay in the process. Prophet says, Lord, let me not miss anything that is happening. Max, no more superficiality. It's time to go deeper. That's right, David. Max says, thank you. Thank God for deliverance. Praise God. That's the other thing. When people have a religious spirit, they almost can't stand a continual message that is, or teaching that is part of the doctrine of the church where it concerns deliverance. Why? Because there's a stronghold that is formed in your mind when you become spiritually blind and you are no longer able to see and hear the truth. And what you begin to do is despise the very things that will set you free. Come on. So the shaking will produce a new level of faith in you, and it is a reality check for you. And I want to tell you what else it produces: healing and growth. So all these things that I've said are to say this: the shaking will produce healing and growth. They work together, but you must stay in the process. Listen, we're talking about process or process, whichever way you want to say it. Because when there is a shaking, some things are established. Who you are and what you know. Who you are and what you know is established. Why is that important? Because we often find our judgment clouded, and we find our destiny clouded, and we find our vision clouded when we are not correctly aligned. And the enemy can speak sweet nothings in your ear, and you won't even know who you are after that. You need to know who you are, and the shaking will establish who you are. You will know after the shaking where you stand and who you are, and you will have to make a decision as on which direction you want to go. The shaking also establishes what you know. Because either your blindness will be removed in the shaking, because you will allow that yieldedness. Either your blindness will be removed and you'll be able to see again, and you'll be able to understand and perceive with your spirit. Are you with me? And so during those times, there's a peeling off of the layers. There's a peeling off of hidden things. There's a peeling off of these veils and these scales that come over our eyes when we cannot see. In this time, because it will produce authenticity in your life, and it will produce a testing of faith. How many of you have noticed that in these difficult times, many have forsaken the faith? It is so sad. Many have forsaken the faith. Can you just put on that 1 Corinthians, or just put on something, Jesus. For the foolishness of God is wiser than human wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than human strength. I don't know if that's one of the ones I quoted, but yeah. Authenticity and the testing of our faith, that's one of the things the shaking will do for you. Either you'll continue to move in a superficial way and pretend the shaking didn't happen, and you'll cover it with pride and all of those things, or you will allow the Lord to expose the things that need to be removed, and there will be an authenticity that will be found in you, because healing will have occurred. And the second thing is the testing of your faith, which produces, Scripture says, perseverance. Amen. Testing of your faith happens because in these difficult times, in these valleys that we are fighting the enemy, God is lifting us up. But we have to stay in the presence. We have to stay positioned correctly so that we do not shift and drift off. Amen. So listen carefully. The purpose of the shaking is not to hurt you, but to bless you. The purpose of the shaking is not to harm you, but to grow you. The purpose of the shaking is to lift you higher. It's part of the process. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I just want to do something here. Oh, it's a bit better. So let me just, so the first thing it does, the first thing it establishes is authenticity, talking about the shaking. The second thing is the testing of your faith, which produces persevering. The third thing is that in a shaking, things are moved or removed. In a shaking, things are moved or removed. Oh, Apostle Shirley says, authenticity, my God, we need to be authentic. Be the authentic church. The world needs the real body of Christ to please stand up. Oh, Apostle, I tell you, that's why I honor and respect you so much. And I honor you because you are an authentic woman of God. Yes. And you see, the thing is, we often, when we have those scales over our eyes, we think people cannot see that we are not being authentic, but people can see. Those that have the things of the Spirit and spiritual discernment can see authenticity. And the young, the Gen Zs and the Gen, what is it?
Alpha.
Gen Alpha are all moving into a place where the thing they want most is what is real. And in the past, that we've lived in a performance-based church. We're living in performance-based ministries. We're living in celebrity status ministries, where it's just become impossible. And things seem so plastic and so unreal. And I'm telling you, saints, exactly what you said, Apostle, is if the only way we come to a place of authenticity is when we lay it all down. Now, I want you to turn with me to Galatians 4:17. Galatians 4:17. When I say things are moved or removed, when I said the third one is in the shaking, things are moved or removed, let me just say this. We are either moved in the direction that God is calling us by the shaking or when we allow things to be removed. Amen? Let me rephrase that. I said it the wrong way around. We are either removed from God and the place we're meant to be, or we move closer to God, which is what I said earlier. But it's when old habits must die first. We've got to change position. We can't compromise anymore. We cannot forego the shaking, just as we cannot forego the process, because it's part of a sign of the times. And that's why I said earlier, if you want to be touched but not changed, you won't grow. Hallelujah. We want Jesus. There you go. There's one of our Gen Alpha speaking. Apostle Shirley says, the next gen is not tolerating the fake. Amen. Don't they have enough fake? And surely we should be leading people into truth. Surely people should see an authenticity in us, a consistency that runs through our lives in every way. Amen. Galatians 4:17. Thank you. That's what I'm looking for. This is what it says. Those people are zealous, Paul says, to win you over, but for no good. Wait. We're talking about authentic versus fake, right? But for no good. What are they? What they want to do is alienate you from us. Let me read this again. Those people, verse 17, are zealous to win you over, but for no good. What they want is to alienate you from us, Paul says, so that you may have a zeal for them. Oh, my word. It's fine to be zealous, provided the purpose is good, and to be so always, not just when I am with you, Paul says. Paul's saying, you better be the same when I'm with you and when I'm not with you. Why? Because healthy leaders don't control unhealed people, force and manipulate. Healthy leaders don't control unhealed leaders and unhealed people, force and manipulate things. And what I believe I want to say to you about the scripture that Paul is saying, that people are there, they're zealous, they show excitement and enthusiasm to win you over, but for no good, because what they want to do is alienate you from us so that you may have a zeal for them. He's talking about the Paul and Apollos story. He's talking about those that have ministries that are not birthed in God. They're manipulators. You can even see sometimes signs and wonders and miracles in there. Come on. What are they being produced by? Because I'm telling you now, the shaking is cleaning up the church. Turn with me to 1 Peter 4:17. 1 Peter 4:17. 1 Peter 4:17. Zarabashatalamatea masa. Bro sikatia. This is what it says. I'm going somewhere. Someone say we're going somewhere.
Hallelujah.
1 Peter 4:17. The Lord is cleaning up the church. The shaking will produce a cleaning up in the church. For it is time for judgment to begin with God's household. And if it begins with us, what will the outcome be for those who do not obey the gospel of God? Don't compartmentalize your faith and feel like it's okay to be holier than thou in the church, but behind the scenes, in the hidden corners, we're doing all sorts of things that are not of the Lord. And then the enemy will put a position of guilt upon you so that you feel like you can't be in your house and all that nonsense. You cannot continue going through those cycles anymore, saints. You've got to know that grace and mercy is upon you, but if you truly want to grow, if you truly are hungry, listen, even those that are in the house of the Lord, and I'm generalizing, can be taken in by the wiles of the enemy while they are in their house, while they are saying yes and amen. In the next breath, they're turning their head and saying yes and amen to someone that's opposing the very one they've just said yes and amen to. You can no longer think, we can't live in a day and age where you think you can be an elder in the church because you've been a Christian for 10 years. You've got to understand, people will overtake you if you're not authentic, if you are not tuned in, if you are not intimately connected to Jesus. because it will show, because there will be a lack of authenticity when you are not truly connected in your faith walk with Jesus, when you are not intimately connected in your prayer life with Jesus, it will show with a lack of authenticity in your life. Because shaking spiritually, what does shaking mean spiritually? Shaking means judgment. It means a sign of the times, and it also means the glory of God. It means all three things. So shaking means a sign of the times. It means judgment. It means the glory of God. You can't be in the church for 10 years and remain the same and think you're going to get away with just doing fake stuff and making people believe you're right there when you're not, because those that have the Spirit will know. They may not say it, but they'll know, and you will not grow. Hallelujah. You have to walk out your faith, because people will know whether you're authentic or not. Paul said, by this time, you ought to be teachers. I'm talking about the shaking, and I'm talking about the process that leads us to spiritual maturity. All of this is in one, because it's all contextual. You need to go back and watch some of my messages. Go and watch Sunday's message that I preached just recently at our DGFC Cape Town church. Go and watch Friday night's message before that, and Thursday night's message, you'll see. And the previous Sunday, God is taking us through some amazing teaching and revelation here. Paul said this in Hebrews 5. Turn with me to Hebrews 5, 11 to 14. I tell you what, we may think, Paul often said in his works, this may be a hard teaching. These are not hard teachings. I was saying to our people in Cape Town, we're not even going to say ouch anymore when something is kind of, oh. We're not even saying AAK anymore, because we recognize the shaking is for our good. Hallelujah. The process is to develop us and to lead us into the place of maturity. Amen, somebody. Hebrews 5 verse 11. Have we got it? Hebrews 5 verse 11. Hebrews 5 verse 11. Yes, Pat, it is powerful. That's right. Harabataya masanda laba shanda. Ouch is our last year's response. We embrace the shaking process. Hebrews 5, listen, two-thirds of the New Testament were written by Paul. And if you don't like what I'm saying, you're not going to like two-thirds of the New Testament, I can promise you. Because we are past the time where we need to preach just this prosperity message, this feel-good message that makes everybody feel good, where they receive a touch from God, but they don't change. I'm telling you, you will be left behind. It is God's mercy and grace that is bringing the shaking, so that we can move closer to the goal, not further away. The Lord is shaking us to wake us up and say, wake up, church. When he said to Elijah, a great prophet who had just done great exploits for him, when he said, come on, Elijah, get up. He was saying it not to admonish him, but to say to him, come on, don't be taken in by the talking of Jezebel, by the murmurings of Jezebel. Don't be walk in fear because of what she said. Look at what I'm doing in your ministry. Look what I'm doing in your midst. Mm. Hebrews 5, 11 to 14, Paul says, I believe it's Paul that wrote Hebrews. We don't know for sure. I have a lot more to say about this, but it is hard to get it across to you. Since you've picked up this bad habit, I can't remember which translation I have. It could be NLT or even the message. Since you've picked up this bad habit of not listening, by this time, yes, you can put that on. Let's see. By this time, you ought to be teachers yourself. Yet here I find you need someone to sit down with you, going over the basics of God again, starting from square one on baby's milk when you should already be on solid food long ago. And then he goes on to say, milk is for beginners, inexperienced in God's ways. Solid food is for the mature who have some practice in telling right from wrong. So what he is saying is really that when will we learn our lessons? If we keep doing the same thing, if we keep falling back into those same habits, those same sins, those same things that God's grace has already given us forgiveness for, and we continue to move into cycles that bind us, and we move back into things that God's already set us free from, and then we keep them hidden because we go, oh no, I can't let them see that I've fallen back into that now. Oh yes, you can. Let the shaking begin.
Come
as many times as you need to come to that altar, you come. And if you need further deliverance, we'll help you through it. But you cannot bypass the season of deliverance, the season of shaking, the season of restoration, the season of making you all to be who God has called you to be, the season of molding. And the thing is, when you feel insecure,
amen,
and you feel inferior, you'll always feel like you're competing. And that's why you often may not want to receive from those that are teachers and leaders and preachers above you. Listen, we don't want people that are just calling themselves by their fivefold name, but they've moved and shifted from where God has called them to be. I'm telling you, God's grace and the grace will always be upon us, but there's been a special grace on the body of Christ. We must not take advantage of that. We must move swiftly in the shaking and let God shake us up. Because you don't understand a healthy parent, son, daughter, what that kind of relationship is when you're still finding yourself in competition and instead of, you know, you're always trying to have the last word and you're always trying to do something better. That is a spirit of pride. I tell you, that is more than that, but let's not go there. Someone said this: spiritual parents don't compete, we complete. Spiritual parents don't compete, we complete. And I tell you what, when we don't get rid of our own insecurities, when we don't let the shaking get us deliverance from our insecurities, our inferiorities, they will eat us up, gobble us up, and spit us out. And we will backslide and eventually leave the church because we have not heard and we have not seen. And hearing and seeing is not just the word on a Sunday. It's taking and receiving the counsel that God wants to give you. When you're not able to hear, you're not able to see, you don't receive, your heart's hardened. And performance-based ministries are being shaken. They're being exposed for what they are. Because Jesus is looking for people that have his heart. Jesus is looking for people that have his love. Jesus is looking for a people that desire to serve him and to live in him and to walk in his manifest presence above all else. Jesus is looking for a people that will, number one, yield themselves fully to the Lord. When we have Jesus' heart, we yield ourselves fully to the Lord. Come on, I'm going to say it to you like this. I just want to give you three things here. When we have Jesus' heart and we have embraced his love, number one, we yield ourselves fully to the Lord. We lay it down, not compliantly, but willingly, because ritual without renewal is religion. Ritual without renewal is just religion. It's nothing more. You know, Mark Chirona, Apostle Mark Chirona, or Bishop Mark Chirona said this. Listen carefully. I'm putting in a lot of things here tonight. He said, the altar alters us.
Woo!
The altar alters us. When you come to the altar, it must alter you. It must bring change, saints. We can't have a fake faith. Somebody say, I'm done with fake faith. Some of you may be insulted that I can even say that. Then just repent and allow the spirit of pride to be broken down so that you can receive. Amen. The second thing, those that have a heart of Jesus and have his love are a people that won't be seduced by power. People that have a genuine heart for Christ won't be seduced and seized by its power. So there's a process to moving towards spiritual maturity. But remember, Jesus had to endure Nazareth to get to Galilee. And that's why I said in the beginning, we have to move through the process. We cannot bypass Nazareth because there is silence and because we feel like it's an awkward place and because we're not recognized and because it's hard ground. You cannot bypass Nazareth. It's where you will grow. Before you get to Galilee, you have to enter your Nazareth. Otherwise, you will be seduced by power and you're going to rely on those crowds, which are fickle, saints. If you are receiving and your motivation is the crowds, then you are not pure in heart. Then exactly what Paul was saying in Corinthians, to say that God will bring to light what is hidden in darkness and will expose the motives of people's hearts. That's exactly what will happen when you become seduced by power. Don't forgo the process. Don't forgo the shaking. James 1:3 says, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. And the NLT says, for you know that when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow. So we don't want to be a people that are seduced by power. Now, I'll tell you what happens often is people that are seduced by power are often people that have not allowed the growth process. In other words, they've been in churches where they haven't been guided and led correctly. And so they have these amazing spiritual gifts. They can feel they've got the spiritual gifts and all they want to do is use them. And we should always, as leaders, be helping them to use whatever measure of that gift in the current equates with their character. Hear me carefully. Allow them to use the measure of the gift that equates with the measure of their character at the time. Nothing more. Because they shall be seduced by power if they are let loose. Amen. And understand this. I'm not talking about some leaders having a spirit of control over you and all that nonsense. I'm saying those that genuinely want to see you prosper and be even greater than they are, because a good leader will always want that. I am saying that those that are trained correctly, where their gifts are used in the right context to start off with, that matches the level of the character, the level of the gift, and then slowly being given. Remember, being proved faithful with the little so that God can give you the much. You don't just get the much and then say, well, I've got the supernatural gift. Why aren't I using it? And, you know, you've barely understood basic doctrines of the faith. So there is a process. And you have to endure Nazareth. Don't try and bypass it because you will be seduced by power. That was number two. Number three, people that have a heart for Christ, people that have his heart, people that have a heart for Jesus, that have his love, that desire to live and walk in his way, do not forgo the process. They don't bypass it. Remember, the gift without the process is short-lived. Because what does process mean? Process is a series of actions or steps that are taken in order to achieve a particular end, a particular goal. That's what process is. It's a series of actions, and if you take the wrong actions and the wrong steps, you are going to move out of your process. You're going to move out of the place that God said. And listen, when that happens and you forgo the process and all you want to do is be established on your gifts without the character being built up, the maturity being built up, do you know what Jesus will say? Like he said in Matthew 7, you'll say, I'm doing miracles and signs and wonders in your name, God. And Jesus will say, away from me, I never knew you. You can read it in Matthew 7. So when we talk about deception being one of the greatest issues in the church, you've got to understand that this is the reality we are living in. I want to just go quickly to Colossians chapter 2. Jesus. Colossians is the book of fullness. And I want you to read, maybe if you're not reading anything, if you don't have a Bible plan, just go and read Colossians. It is the book of fullness. It is the book of fullness. But I want you to read from verse 8, because I'm going to first read from verse 6. I want to just read this part and then we're going to underline verse 8. This is what I'm going to come to a close with. So then, just as you receive Christ, Paul says, just as you receive Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live your lives in him. Rooted and built up in him and strengthened in the faith as you were taught and overflowing with thankfulness. Verse 8, listen carefully. See to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition and the elemental spiritual forces of this world rather than on Christ. For in Christ, all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form, and in Christ, you have been brought to the fullness. You have been brought into a place of fullness, but you have to. You have to be one who doesn't forego the process, who isn't seduced by power. In other words, don't get all starry-eyed because you have these spiritual gifts and now you're rebelling because you're going, oh, my pastor won't let me use them right now. We want you to use them in the measure that you are ready for. And that you need to be yielded to use them. Amen. Because the shaking is going to expose everything and it's going to draw you closer to the fire, or it's going to put you in a furnace that has nothing to do with the fire of the Lord. Amen. And Paul goes on in verse 28 of chapter 1. He says, he is the one we proclaim, admonishing and teaching everyone with all wisdom, so that we may present everyone fully mature in Christ. And he goes on to say, it's to this end that I continuously, strenuously contend with all the energy, because Christ works so powerfully in me. He is so pumped, Paul, about the gospel, and he sees the end of what people will become as they follow the heart of God. He sees the fullness of God operating in them even before it's operating. And he goes, that's the spiritual maturity I want you to reach. That's where I want you. Don't despise the shaking. Don't break the parts of the shaking that expose things in your life because of pride. Don't despise these words that are coming in the time of the valley, because we are in a war, saints. We are still in a spiritual war. The devil wants your soul. He wants you to take offense. He wants you to bite on every bit of offense that you can. He wants you to be so offended that you were one day busy praising your leader, one day busy praising God in the sanctuary, one day busy committing to the covenant you've made with your house and your leaders and your family of God, and the next day in 24/7 you take offense at something someone says and you say, I'm leaving. You've got to know that comes from the pit of hell. You've got to know that comes from an unhealed soul. You've got to know that part of the shaking involves the process, and part of the process involves the deliverance that God is doing among the churches right now, to bring purity, to bring those blind eyes to a place of seeing, to bring deaf ears to a place of hearing. Because he said to them, remember, he said, you know, even though you see, you do not see. Even though you hear, you cannot hear. That's spiritual blindness, saints. And so the Lord is lifting us to a new place. There's so much in Colossians I want to go to, but I want to finish with this. That's why he says in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 1 to 9, 1 Corinthians 3, 1 to 9, he says, brothers and sisters, Paul says, I could not address you as people who live by the Spirit, but people who are still worldly, even infants in Christ. I gave you milk, not solid food, for you weren't ready for it. Indeed, you're still not ready. Now, who is Paul addressing here? He's addressing the church, because he's saying, if you remain an infant, if you remain like a baby in Christ, you are going to be blown like chaff here, there, and everywhere. And what keeps you as a spiritual infant? What keeps you from spiritually maturing? What keeps you from growth? The decisions you make that move out of obedience to the Lord's will for your life. Because the spirit of control and all those things that you need deliverance from are still binding you and blinding you not to be able to see the things that are keeping you from your growth. Come on. That's why he said you are still worldly, having the very nature of the flesh, under the control of the world, under the government of human nature, not God. And then he says, that's why there's jealousy and quarreling among you. Are you not worldly, acting like mere humans? For one says, I follow Paul, and another says, I follow Apollos. Oh my God, I want to tell you something. People are leaving churches all over the world in droves because they cannot take the shaking. And in a spiritful church, there's going to be an exposure and there's going to be a shaking. And for those people that have had time and time again come to a crossroads, but they've never ever come to a crossroads where the exposure is like this, they are either going to fall or they're going to fly. That's what's going to happen. He says, who's Paul and who's Apollos? What do you hear? It's not, neither of them waters. It's only God that grows them. Only God can make it grow, not the one who just plants. And so you have to recognize and understand what God is doing right now in the body of Christ and not despise the shaking and not despise any correction. Your leaders love you. Listen, saints, as I said, the spirit of offense is rife in the church. And right now the enemy is going around like a roaring lion. People are leaving and they're going, oh, I don't want to follow Paul anymore. I'm going to follow Apollos. It's much more comfortable over here. Oh, I'm going to get the rah-rah. I'm going to get the prophecies that speak into my life, all the good things that God's going to do and the businesses I'm going to own. And you know what? None of that is untrue, of course, if it's of the Lord. But most, you cannot have just feel-good prophecy, saints, and say that that's all God. And how many of those people have walked in those prophecies and lived in their prophecies? We've got to make sure the prophecies that we're hearing are of the Lord, not just those that are mixed with flesh that are there to manipulate you. Come on. Everything that can be shaken is going to be shaken. Spiritual warfare is real, and that's why we're in a season of growth. We're in a season of deliverance. We're in a season of the shaking right now. Because he says in chapter 3, he says, since, chapter 3, verse 1 of Colossians, he says, since then you have been raised with Christ. Somebody say, I've been raised with Christ. Set your hearts on things above. Is everybody quiet? Oh, yes. Oh, Pastor Relene, hello, good evening, we love you. Can you put that up? Correction is good and godly principle. Embrace it and grow. Amen. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. Put to death, listen carefully, saints, verse 5. Chapter 3. Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature. Come on. What do you think that is? That's the yielding part of the process. Put to death whatever belongs to your earthly nature. Sexual immorality, impurity. Here he even lists some of them. Lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. And then he goes on to say to them and remind them, remember, you used to walk in these ways in the life you once lived. But now you must rid yourself of all such things. Anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other. Saints, I cannot tell you how I've even seen fivefold lie to my face. They don't know that I know they're lying, but I know. I tell you, you've got to be careful. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in the knowledge and the image of its creator. Isn't that beautiful? And then he says in verse 12, therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves. Then he says, take off all those things. They don't belong to you anymore. Gossip is not your portion. Poverty is not your portion. Anger is not your portion. Rage is not your portion. Slander is not your portion. Malice is not your portion. Offense is not your portion. And we can go on forever. He says, Christ is your portion. He says, now clothe yourself, take those things off and put on, clothe yourselves with compassion, with kindness, with humility, with gentleness, and with patience, and bear with each other and forgive one another. For if anyone, listen carefully, has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them together in perfect unity. That's the one thing I can never understand. You know, saints, we are quick to want people to forgive us. But when we come to needing to forgive, to repent, and to reconcile relationships in the church, I've seen people walk out because they refuse to do so. And they harbor bitterness and malice in their hearts for years afterwards. And all they are consumed by is destroying that church, destroying that ministry. Seriously. It's scary, and they don't even have a life. And then he says in verse 15, let the peace of Christ rule in your heart, since as members of one body you were called to peace, and be thankful. Let the message dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another. See, that's the thing about taking a stand. That's the thing about taking off the old self. That's the thing about being resurrected in the power of God. You don't want to stand for lies. You don't want to stand in a place where people are deceptive. You don't want to be in that. And you will correct people in your midst where you are an extension of your church. You are an extension of Jesus Christ. And if somebody comes to you and they speak garbage, you should correct them. The scripture's clear here. It says, admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word and deed, do it in the name of the Lord, giving thanks to God. And then it goes on to speak about us submitting ourselves to one another. So what am I saying, saints? I'm not even going to go to Ephesians 4. I preached it and taught it. You can go and watch it if you want to. I'm saying that we are in the shaking. Don't despise the time of the shaking. Don't see it offensively. Don't see it as something bad happening to you. Don't see it as a time where you're feeling like, oh my word, you know, sure, these are sobering words in the next TNL. And listen, the Lord is taking us all through a process, a season of deliverance, a season of moving through an open door because God wants to see us flourish. A season of shaking. We're in the valley. We're in a war zone. And God wants us to be equipped with the best that we can be because spiritual warfare is a real thing. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Yes. We must devote ourselves to prayer, the scripture says. We must be watchful and thankful because God will open a door. Amen. God will open a door for you to proclaim the gospel, but you've got to look like Jesus for it to have an impact. You've got to be able to clothe yourselves with compassion, clothe yourself with love, clothe yourself with a spirit, clothe yourself in the gospel, shod your feet in the gospel, put on the full armor of God. Make sure that you're devoting yourself to prayer. Devotion is something that we literally make special time for. We devote ourselves. We give full attention to that thing. We devote ourselves. It's there in chapter 4 of Colossians verse 2. Devote yourselves to pray. It doesn't say, listen, just pray. It says, devote yourselves. Give all attention to your prayer life so that you can change. You don't just want to touch from the Lord. You want to be changed into his likeness. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Somebody say hallelujah.
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 Praise the Lord. Let's just have a time of prayer and maybe even prophecy, who knows? Orere shindai, soreba shandatayai, brokata masandalai, bro shindai. Did you put this on already? Okay, thank you. Irere shindai. Oh, we bless you, Lord. Thank you for all those that are online right now. We just want to go into this time where we lift up our hands and say, Lord, just take us. We take off all those garments, Lord, those garments like Joshua 3 speaks about, that we need to take off unclean garments. We need to take off unclean garments right now. There might be some things that you've been doing, some things you've been saying, and you know the difference between right and wrong. You know what's good and what's not. And you're justifying some of those things. The Lord says, just take them off. Take off those old garments right now. Because I can see. I can see. Spirit of God, come right now. Lift up your hands, saints. We're taking off the old. The people that have left Paul to follow Apollos. They've moved out of ministry because they refused to follow the process. And I tell you why, because their eyes, their hearts were hardened. And therefore their eyes could no longer see and their spirits could no longer receive. And they turned and were blind. And they thought they could see. And this is what is happening in the shaking. This is what is happening in the shaking. The Lord says, take off those old garments. Take off those grave clothes, prophet saying. Take off the things that are weighing you down. Take off those things that have set themselves up in your mind and in the darkness. Throw them off. They're holding you in bondage. And even, I just want to speak out. Ministers that are on here right now, those that are ministers in the Word of God right now, I want to speak over your lives, if I may. I just want to say that even for you, that you would take off the weariness, that you would take off those garments that have weighed you down, those burdens that you're carrying of weightiness, weighty burdens that you've carried, burdens of prayer for people in your ministries. God wants to bring a full restoration to us as the fivefold. We've carried certain weights that we need to give to the Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Even those things that have, some ministers have been so beaten up. Some ministers have had to carry heavy loads. They've had to walk with dusty shoes. They've had to take knives put in their backs. They've had to take people leaving their churches and not understanding why. I've just explained to you why. Hearts grow cold. People disobey the Lord. They don't want to remove stubborn-heartedness. They don't want to remove the spirit of pride. They don't want to let go of the things God's saying let go of. And ministers love you. Your ministers, your pastors love you. They love you. When you go, it hurts because they can see that you're forsaking, you're giving up your destiny. See, it's not just choosing Apollos or Paul. It's being where God has planted you. It's being rooted in and established where you have been made covenant with God, where God is establishing you. It's in that house that you are called to be planted. And I'm asking you, if you're carrying pride, if you're carrying bitterness, if you're carrying anything that is hindering you from being all you can be, a spirit of control, if you're carrying things where you, do you know a spirit of control is birthed out of fear? I know that I've said this before, but there are people on here that have not heard it. Always remember, if you're thinking, oh, apostle's saying it again, you've got to know there are people that haven't heard it, and it might do good to hear it again. And I'm saying this because we don't want anybody to fall. And we are at the heart of the spiritual warfare as ministers. And we are seeing things around us all over the world, in, you know, all over in churches of people that are just forsaking their faith. They think they're not. They think they're not doing it, but they are. They are. They're giving up. They're selling their inheritance for a pot of stew. They're giving up their inheritance for a pot of stew. There is a deception. There is a deception that has come to the church. Don't think for a second that you cannot be deceived because you're a believer. Throw those things off right now. Throw them off. Throw them off. Throw it off, 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 throw it off right now. Siraba, you weren't born blind. The Lord would say you were not born spiritually blind. I've given you eyes to see and I've given you a heart to know. I've given you a spirit that has been made new in my likeness. Lay down those things right now, the Lord would say. Throw off the old garments. Throw off the filthy robes. Throw off the things that have hindered you. Throw off the stubborn-heartedness. Throw off the spirit of pride. Throw off the things that have masked the truth that you have kept hidden for so long. The Lord says, for this is the time and this is the season that my grace shall be applied. But there is coming a time where there will be shortness of my breath. O Rabalade Setaya. I am breathing. I'm breathing over my body of Christ right now. I'm breathing new life. I'm breathing new breath into you. Receive it right now. But take off the old and clothe yourselves with compassion and kindness and love. Put on all these things, and above all, put on love. Ramataya, you cannot love unless you have released these things, unless you have allowed the softening of your heart, unless you have allowed the process, unless you walk in obedience to my word, says the Lord. For the word says that those that will come will not put up any longer with sound doctrine, but they will only hear what their itching ears want to hear. And saints, I'm afraid we're seeing so much of that right now. The problem is that we are at the precipice of this kingdom age where God is moving fast. And there are those that have just continued to stand on the precipice. They've stood on the edge for so long that they think they can continue to live their lives in both worlds and it will be okay because they've done it for so long. And I'm telling you, saints, the shaking will not stop until you let go of the one or the other.
Amen.
Help us to let go of the right thing. Help us to throw away the things that you have called us to leave, Lord. What can I speak out here? What have you? Where is the... We need to keep hearing it, Apostle. Amen, Alongs. Amen, Monica. Yes, Jesse, thank you for the shaking. Lord, help me, guide me. Yes. Come on, Jesse, I tell you what, I know in my spirit, I saw there are things that have kept you in bondage for so many years. It's not everything that has affected your life has come from decisions you've made as an adult. So much of what has affected your life, I believe the Lord has shown me, has come from even your childhood. Some things in your adulthood, but much from your childhood. The way that you were shaped and certain worldviews that you had formed and deep roots of rejection and neglect came upon you. And I want to say I break those things off you right now. And I believe the Lord is making you whole. You've come full circle and full cycle so many times. But the Lord is saying, I'm building you up and I'm taking you a new way. Go in the way of the footsteps of the Lord. The Lord will lead you and guide you. Don't turn left and don't turn right, Jesse. Yes, come out of the grave clothes. Amen, Jackie. It's all in the process. Amen. Hallelujah. And you've been part of our Cape Town team. Just amazing. I just love how you take in the word of God. And I just speak over your life too right now, Jackie. Lift up your hands. If you're still on with us, let us know. You've been part of the teaching and training that we had in Cape Town now on process. God is taking us through this process, and I speak over your life right now, Jackie. Lift your hands up. For I am making you and I am shaping you. I am shaping you. In the shaking, there is a shaping. I see that there is more. The Lord is just causing you to continually lay down these things. For I am molding you and raising you up to a level you have not seen and a level you have not been in my spirit. For in this next year, says the Lord, you will not recognize yourself if you will follow me with your whole heart, with everything you are, and continue through the process, Jackie. For I see the Lord taking you to new heights. I saw the Lord adorning your head with almost like what a nun puts on their head. It's like a habit, but it was part of your identity that you haven't, that you will yet come into in the Lord. And it will be a revelation of the glory of God. It's going to change everything for you. I don't know what you've put up here, but yes, I love what people have said. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Yes, hallelujah. Oh, thank you everybody for your super stickers. And thank you for your stars on Facebook. We want to bless you. We want to just pray that even as you give, and even right now as you give, I don't even know where that thing is. Even as you give, we want to just encourage you, please, to sow a seed if the Lord is calling you to sow a seed into this ministry. Prophet and I are making some really big faith decisions right now. And we are believing supernaturally for all that God has for us as we move into this part of our process. And thank you. I always see it's incredible. Those with you, just amazing. Let's just mention those that have given super stickers. It's Max has given a super sticker. Thank you, Max. Tia, thank you for your super sticker. Oh, we got two super stickers. Sheldon, thank you. You always give a super sticker. Thank you, you and Max. Thank you for your super stickers. Thank you for your stars. I want to encourage you once again, if you haven't subscribed, please help us. It really helps us if you do subscribe. And if you like this broadcast, and even more so, share it with somebody just right now. I also want to encourage you, those that are with us here at DGFC in Durban, those that know Jake, thank you. Those that know Jake, I want to just invite you as well on the Facebook page of, let me just get, I don't know if it's on Wayne's or on Tracy's. I think it is on Tracy's. On Tracy's Facebook, Jake's mom, her memorial service will be broadcast live. I think it's 10 p.m. tonight for those of you that are still awake. It may be still on there for replay. I'm not sure. But I know that they will be broadcasting it live. And we keep Jake in our prayers right now as he prepares his heart for this memorial to bring closure to his mom's passing, his mom's recent passing. Yeah. It's under Tracy. Thank you, Prophet. It's under Tracy Man Lumgwai. I don't know if you can all see that. I'm going to try and as best I can to bring that as close as I can. There it is. Thank you, Lord. We bless your name. Thank you, Lord. We want to bless you all and thank you. And we're going to send you, if I can find my outro, we're going to send you off with our outro and say thank you for being here with us. We love you. God bless you.